going to restart our day, which is going beautifully well. I think we've had two stellar panels this morning, but our afternoon is no less distinguished. We have two panels planned for this afternoon, and I hope that we will see everybody here. It's almost a full house here and in the boardroom at 5 o'clock when we finished. We're delighted to have all of you here on a Friday. Few housekeeping items. Please silence your music toys. I'll do that with mine. I'm always guilty of that. Those things that ring and make music. And there will be a question and answer period right after each panel. And we're going to have more of that actually on this panel. The afternoon panels will be the one that I will be moderating. And it has to do with the negotiations. And U.S. mediation in the future of Palestine, which is probably one of the most timely issues at this time. The last panel will be no less important. It has to do with Jerusalem. And I'm going to take, as somebody from the district of Jerusalem, just a few seconds to say that, since I'm not a panelist, till the problem, one, till the issue of Palestine is settled, there probably will not be peace in the universe. And two, till the issue of Jerusalem is settled in the most appropriate and fair manner, there will be no solution for the Palestine problem. Regardless of what my generation of with gray hair and so on will say to that or sign to that and so on. Having it probably gotten out of line, I'm out of order. I will also mention to our online viewers, and there has been a significant presence online today, that they can tweet their questions to @PalestineCenter, and they can follow us at hashtag PCConf, C-O-N-F, 2014. Now, the bios I failed this morning to mention, but I'm sure everybody who has gotten one of these programs realize that the bios of every speaker and the moderators are in this pamphlet, as well as the pictures. So I hope that you will take a chance to look at them later. Our third panel for the day was, of course, mentioned here to have three panelists and a moderator. It's very unfortunate that Doc Sigmund will not be joining us today because he could not get on a plane from New York. Secondary, you know, OBGYN doctor there says take the bus. It's not an issue of labor and that you can just wait for anyhow. No, because of the flu, which he apologizes for not being able to be here. Our thoughts and prayers are with him for a quick recovery. And hopefully he will be here at another time. We will keep that invitation open for Professor Sigmund to join us. With us today are two distinguished panelists who will take care of the issue of the negotiations, the moderation by the mediation by the United States. First, Khaled Elgindy will be our first speaker. He's a fellow at the Saban Center for Middle East Policy at the Brookings Institution in Washington, D.C. He previously served as an advisor to the Palestinian leadership in Ramallah on permanent status negotiations with Israel 2004 to 2009. Don't know of anybody who is more qualified to speak on that from the Palestinian side, and was a key participant in the Annapolis negotiations of 2008. Most of you are familiar with that. He's the author of numerous publications on Arab-Israeli affairs, Palestinian politics, Egypt's transition, and related subject, including, and these are very important, the Middle East Quartet, a post-mortem, which is a Brookings Institution publication of February 2012. Palestine goes to the United Nations, understanding the new statehood strategy. Again, this was published in Foreign Affairs, September, October 2011, as well as the impact on the peace process, peacemaker or peacebreaker. Authored with Salman Sheikh and the Palestinians between national liberation and political legitimacy. These are in the recent Brookings volume, The Arab Awakening, America and the Transformation of the Middle East, November 2012. With us also is Professor Ian Lustick. And I'm delighted that both of them can be here. Dr. Lustick is the Bess W. Hyman Chair at the University of Pennsylvania and a recipient of so many awards. It's difficult actually to mention all of them, but I'll mention some from the Carnegie Corporation, the National Science Foundation, the National Endowment of the Humanities, the Social Sciences Research Council, and the United States Institute of Peace. Before coming to Penn, Professor Lustick taught for 15 years at Dartmouth College and worked for 1 year in the Department of State. His present research include the politics of Jewish and non-Jewish migration into and out of Palestine, the land of Israel, and on prospects for peace between Israelis and Palestinians. That's the very topic that we're talking about today. He is a past president of the politics and history section of the American Political Science Association and of the Association for Israel Studies, and a member, he is also a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. This is a summary, just a small summary of the qualifications of these two prominent gentlemen who will be here today to talk about the mediation. All of us have witnessed the mediation since probably the Madrid conference in the very early 90s. So you're talking about over 20 years of mediation. Where did we get? And can there, Washington, D.C. insists that mediation for the Israel-Palestine or Palestine-Israel question must go through Washington, D.C., where all of us sit here today. Well, over the last 20 to 25 years, nothing has happened. As late as the last few days, meetings in the Middle East between Secretary Kerry and stakeholders, again, did not hold any promise. Can the United States mediation succeed? What needs to change? If not in Washington, where should Palestinians look to advance their goals? Can Palestinian liberation be achieved without Washington, D.C.? Israel's biggest supporter involved. We will discuss these questions, and since Professor Siegman is not going to be here, there will be adequate and plenty of time for question and answers. So look into that. I'm going to ask Khaled to start. Go ahead.
From here? Okay.
You have 10 to 15 minutes to start from here, maybe. You can use here.
Thank you, and thank you to the Palestine Center for inviting me. Let me start off maybe by framing the issue with a fundamental paradox that I think will be cover not just my presentation, but I think Professor Lustick's also, and I think you'll find that our remarks are very complementary. The basic paradox, essentially, as far as the U.S. role in this process is concerned, is that on the one hand, you have the United States is generally recognized as the only party that can bring the parties together, the only actor that can bring the parties together to bring about a deal. And also at the very same time, it's also the only party that won't do what's actually needed to get us there. I think we all know essentially what's required, and yet there are, for a whole host of reasons, why the United States can't take certain steps. And it's not just a matter of current behavior, the Obama administration. I think the trend lines are clear as far as both the administration and the Congress. You find a very, even I would say increasingly hostile environment on Capitol Hill to almost anything Palestinian, much more indifference to the idea of a two-state solution, used to be sort of the litmus test. And now I think it's like, as in many places, it's sort of passé to talk about the two-state solution. So certainly in Congress, you see this trend. You see much less tolerance for Palestinian perspectives on Capitol Hill. But it's also, I think, very much true of the administration as well. And even though there were a lot of high hopes for the Obama administration, I think at a minimum, the administration has not lived up to those hopes. And I think there's actually quite a bit of disappointment. And I would argue that, in fact, there's been an erosion and a regression in many ways as far as U.S. policy is concerned. And we saw that, I think, saw an example of that during the Gaza War, where there was enormous reluctance on the part of the administration to speak out on the civilian casualties, the overwhelming civilian casualties, even though there was very well-established precedent by both the White House and the State Department under both Democratic and Republican administrations, where there was much more kind of forthcoming criticism toward Israel, including by none other than George W. Bush, who famously told Ariel Sharon, enough is enough. And the scale of destruction and killing a decade ago or more during the Second Intifada was certainly nothing like what we saw in Gaza and in a very short period of time. So there's this increased reluctance to criticize and I think also increased reluctance to do what's needed. And I think if they continue on this track, the Obama administration, I think, may very well be the first administration in 40 years or more that has not moved the needle even a bit, has not broken any new ground in terms of Israeli-Palestinian peace. Of course, that's arguable depending on how you define, but in my understanding, in my analysis, there's not been anything groundbreaking. Even George W. Bush, again, not known for his sympathies toward the Palestinians, was at least the first to make the idea of a Palestinian state official U.S. policy. And there were precedents going all the way back to the Nixon administration and Carter and so on. And yet Obama is in something like a holding pattern. And it's also not a problem just of failed negotiations. Yes, it's true the Annapolis process failed, and not surprisingly, many of us wrote that the latest round of negotiations would also fail, just as they failed in 2010. In fact, they failed back then, even before they got off the ground. It's really a much more holistic failure than that. You know, we used to talk about all peace and no process. That was the sort of main critique of the U.S.-led peace process. But today, there's not even a process to speak of. So there's no peace and there's no process. And by that, I mean that the entire infrastructure, or the architecture, if you will, of peace has been bit by bit sort of eliminated from the Oslo committees on incitement and things like that in the 1990s. To in the 2000s, you had kind of the continuation of the process under a new, heading called the roadmap. The roadmap for peace that was designed by the International Quartet, and you had certain expectations of the two sides. There would be a settlement freeze. There would be a cessation of violence by both sides. There was built in this notion of mutuality, and an inherent understanding that things like settlements and home demolitions contribute not only to lack of confidence in the process, or as signs of ill will, but also as harmful and actually as causes of violence in and of themselves. And I think, for all of its flaws, and there are many, many, the roadmap at least recognized this fundamental connection between ongoing settlement activity and all that goes with it, land confiscation, home demolitions, denial of residency rights, and the gradual dispossession of Palestinians in order to essentially replace them with Israeli Jews, that process would lead to violence, and at least the roadmap understood that. So all of that doesn't exist, you know. Not that the Oslo and the roadmap were the panacea for, and nor am I advocating that we go back to Oslo or the roadmap. I think we're well beyond that. They were deeply flawed to begin with, and are at this point completely outdated. But there's simply nothing to take its place. At a minimum, you had the parties were at a certain point at least invested enough in the process. And at least, at a minimum, those mechanisms that existed at least had established some sort of a baseline by which to measure progress, even if only in aspirational terms. Today we have nothing like that. We have simply the pleadings of an American Secretary of State, and I think it was rather striking during the Gaza War to watch Secretary Kerry as he was carrying out his shuttle diplomacy, traveling all over the region, and essentially shut out of the process in a way that I think was quite humiliating. Certainly, just as an observer, it was difficult to watch. I think I felt embarrassed for him as an American. He was cut out of the process by the two main actors who could have brought this to a quick close, the Egyptians and the Israelis, and was also, they sort of heaped insults upon him when he tried to intervene. So you have this kind of waning American influence, which is a common theme across the Middle East and in American foreign policy in general. And so the U.S. doesn't have the kind of cachet that it used to, the kind of influence that it used to, and I think it's sort of self-perpetuating. So the reality comes down to this, that there is really nothing to constrain the two parties from doing whatever they want. Mahmoud Abbas will go to the UN, Israel will build more settlements, it can deploy its military whenever and however it wants. There's almost a limitless capacity to rely on the military, and there are no constraints. It really just comes down to basic power dynamics, and it should be no surprise that the reality is much more unfavorable to Palestinians than to Israelis, just given that power dynamic. And so I'll just end with this point, and that is, I don't necessarily have the solution. And again, I'm not advocating that we go back to defunct and essentially ineffective and bankrupt mechanisms from Oslo or the Quartet or the roadmap. But it's clear that something needs to be inserted into this vacuum. And this is where American leadership is essential. And I think one way forward is that instead of having an American monopolized process, which is what we've had for most of the last 20 years, with some window dressing called the Quartet and some other things, but essentially American-dominated peace process, I think the United States' role is essential, but I think it can no longer even attempt to dominate this process. It needs regional support, clearly. It can't do much without regional partners. But it also, I think there are key roles for both the United Nations in terms of reinserting the whole notion of international legitimacy and international law as a standard and as a standard by which to hold parties accountable. I think this is essential. And in that respect, I think the United States can do quite a bit, if not directly by commission, at least by omission, by not standing in the way of the pursuit of initiatives at the Security Council or the International Criminal Court and other forums. Not that I think that that's likely, but I do think that it's possible, even in this very charged political environment. And with that, I will look forward to hearing from Professor Lustick.
Thank you, and I want to thank the organizers of what, for me also, has been a wonderfully informative and stimulating conference, and I look forward to the discussion. I know we have a generous or adequate question and answer period. For myself, I don't insist on questions, and I don't claim to have all the answers. So if you just have a comment on what I have to say, I'll entertain that as well, but you'll get a response. You know, some of you may know, about 14 months ago, I published a piece in the New York Times about this two-state illusion. One of the main thrusts of that piece was that the Kerry negotiations were going to fail. And that was a very easy prediction to make, as we've heard. But I'm going to make another easy prediction, and that is that they're going to start again. That is not necessarily Kerry, but there's going to be another round. And I want to try to explain in my presentation why this is going to happen, why we are caught in this hamster wheel. And once we arrive at a deeper understanding of that, what can we make of it? So I want to tell a story that Alexander Solzhenitsyn tells about the 1930s in the Soviet Union. Some of you may know it if you've read the Gulag. It's a story about a factory, about a meeting, a Communist Party meeting in Georgia, in which there was a whole hall of communist functionaries, including several up on the stage. And Stalin's name was mentioned. And everyone rose and started clapping. And they were clapping for 3 and 4 minutes and 5 minutes and 20 minutes. And finally, they were getting exhausted. One of the, he ran a factory in the area. This man on the stage sat down. And everyone immediately sat down, stopped clapping, and they started to do their business. And that night, the man who sat down was arrested by the KGB. He was interrogated, sentenced to 5 years in the Gulag. According to the story, before he was sent away, the interrogator told him, "I have one piece of advice for you. Never be the first to stop clapping." When I told this story in Ramallah, Nabil Shath was in the audience, and he said, "Yes, we are all still clapping." And I said, "Yes, you understand exactly why this hamster wheel turns. It's called, in political science, a Nash equilibrium." If you saw the movie The Beautiful Mind, Well, that was about John Nash, who discovered, invented this idea of a Nash equilibrium. They don't do a very good job in the movie of explaining what this is. I'm going to try to do it very quickly. It's basically everybody is doing something which is terrible for them, but it's the best they can do given that everyone else is also doing what's best for them. And although everybody would like to escape from this, nobody can be the first one to do it. That's a Nash equilibrium, and it's a very common. But it's what we see here is we have four key actors, and none of them like this hamster wheel. They would all prefer something else. The Palestinian Authority would love a real two-state solution with East Jerusalem as its capital. They would love it. But given that that's not going to happen, and they don't want to lose $500 million a year in salaries and support, they will participate in this hamster wheel. the Israeli right-wing governments would love to have the Palestinian problem, say nothing of the Palestinians themselves, just go away and have the world stop bothering them about it. Let them do whatever they want in the West Bank and in East Jerusalem. And not have to talk about just two states, which, of course, they don't believe in. But if they have to expose, if the right-wing government has to expose itself as actually opposed to what most Israelis want and what the entire world wants, as opposed to pretending that they're endorsing a two-state solution, well, they'll get jump on the hamster wheel, too. The United States, any administration in the United States, and I'm going to go into this in detail, would love to have the end of this problem, especially an American brokered version where there are two states, two viable states, and they don't have this thing constantly coming on top of them. But that's not going to happen. And the main thing for an administration is to not have AIPAC on your back constantly. Well, if they're in an active or semi-active diplomatic process with the Israelis, then they can just turn to the AIPAC and say, wait a minute. You know, we're working with the Israeli government. You can't criticize us now. You're criticizing the Israeli government. Of course, you're not always in diplomatic negotiations, as we just heard, but there's the cycle is not just the negotiations. The cycle is the buildup of a demand for negotiations because of, look at the violence. Isn't this horrible? We have to start the negotiations again. And then pressure will build up. You know, very self-confident American lawyer will be in charge of some part of the government who said the only reason why this problem has not been solved yet is I have not been given the responsibility for solving it, and you'll be off to the races again. Okay, we've left out one other player, and that's the peace process industry, which benefits enormously. Of course, they would love a solution. I don't think of them cynically. I've been a part of this industry. We would love to have a solution, but if we don't have a solution, the hamster wheel can also work for us because it's constantly giving us the reasons why people should give us money, either because now is the last chance, so if not now, when? And if we don't start the negotiations, we'll never be able to have peace, so we've got it now more than ever. You know what the letters say when you get them. So everybody still is constantly clapping. Everyone knows. Absolutely knows there's no hope for a diplomatic process toward a two-state solution under current circumstances, but that doesn't mean they're going to not continue to clap for the reasons that that prisoner figured out. Okay. Now, let's ask why. And I am going to, why are we caught in this? And I will take the United States. I agree that the United States is not the only actor. Any future successful process will have to enlist the UN, the Europeans, but I don't know any path from here to there that's going to get those things to happen without the United States pushing it. But I agree in principle. But I want to ask right now, you need to understand why the most important actor in this quartet, the quartet I just described, is unable to change. Why? And that's a structural feature of American politics. It's a deep structural feature of the American politics. Now, I'm sure many of you, if not most of you, are aware of the book by Mearsheimer and Walt, The Israel Lobby. I am a great fan of the two of them and of the book, but it's not a perfect book. There's a lot that is actually wrong in it, and one fundamental thing that's wrong in it is the horror that they express on the basis that, can you believe it? In this situation, American interests are not driving American policy. Wow, how could that happen? Must be this Israel lobby, which if not for the Israel lobby, of course U.S. national interests would be in the driver's seat. I've asked, actually, John. So tell me, John, tell me one area in world politics, one, just one, where American policy is actually, in your view, driven by real American interests. At that particular moment, he couldn't think of one. The fact is that that's not how foreign policy is made in the United States. It never is driven by some national interest disembodied from political interest. Let me just prove this in 1 minute. We know that American foreign policy towards the Arab-Israeli conflict is three standard deviations away from the world mean. Okay, it's an outlier. It's really weird. Okay? Three standard deviations mean you should never see it unless you live about 14 lives. Okay, so there is one other policy that the American government pursues that is like that, that is at least three standard deviations from the mean of the international community. There's one other. I can't think of only one other. Not climate change. We're, you know, what is that other one? Cuba. Exactly. What do these two issues have in common? Oh, I know. Both of them have to do with being against boycotts. No, that doesn't work. What do they have in common? There is a single issue political lobby in the United States that matters domestically. In Cuba's case, it just matters in a couple states. In the Israeli case, it matters more, but it doesn't take much. The Israel lobby could be much weaker than it is, and you'd still have Cuba. You know that the last vote, every October, they take a vote in the UN on Cuba. It's 180-2 about whether to continue the embargo, to end the embargo. The two are the United States and Israel. It's just an interesting factoid. The votes on Israeli and Arab stuff is usually about 150-5 or 150-7. All right. So if I've just shown that it's not national in this particular case, the national interest is overridden by a particular group. If we can only get no, that is not to understand just how difficult this problem is. The problem is much deeper than that. And here's where I'm going. In order to explain this about the structure of U.S. policies, I have to teach you another couple social science concepts, not just Nash equilibrium, but type 1 versus type 2 errors. Have you ever heard of that? In statistics, in social science, a type 1 error is an error of commission. You act when you should not have acted. A type 2 error, or if you accept the hypothesis is true when it's really false. A type 2 error is an error of omission. I should have acted, but I didn't. Right, you got that? Type 1 error is, oh my God, I shouldn't have done that. Type 2 error is, oh, I should have done that. All right? Two different kinds of errors. Our founding fathers, when they set up this country, were mainly afraid of type 1 errors. They did not want a strong government that would go and do things and express its power by affecting the property or the lives or the beliefs of the people who formed the government. They were thinking about King George. But they were also thinking as good, solid liberals. They wanted a weak central government. And the way Madison, if you read Federalist 10, it's about dividing power so agonizingly that nothing will ever get done. You see what a great job they did. That is exactly how they gerrymandered everything. So if anything did get done, it would have to be something that almost everybody wanted to do. Because if you tried to, okay. That's how they set up domestic American politics. Don't make any type 1 errors. But of course, you're going to make a lot of type 2 errors. The government's going to pass up a lot of situations where it should have acted but didn't. But at least we're not going to have a lot of type 1 errors. The difficulty is that that's already a difficulty. But what is not often understood is that foreign policy is different. In foreign policy, there's, you know, in Vietnam, think about how many Vietnamese voters there were in the 1960s here in the United States to strike back against those who were hurting their interests in Congress by funding the war. There were none. Foreign policy is an area where a president and an administration can finally be free of these shackles, of these Lilliputian shackles that otherwise make him feel like he has no power, even though he's supposed to be the most powerful person in the world. Foreign policy, you can strut. You can actually make a statement. You can have a policy. And a tradition of bipartisanship, has been a tradition of bipartisan foreign policy, gave you a much greater freedom. Then in the 20th century, something else got added to that. And that was a huge and growing, now it's utterly spectacular, gap between the amount of power the United States has to project its military force and the amount of power that others have. And because of that gap, it seems very easy for presidents to get involved because there's no opposition at home. Nobody really cares about foreign policy and knows even less. And because you're never going to lose an all-out battle overseas. You might get hurt later, but you've got so much power, it looks like a little investment, and you save 40,000 people from getting annihilated in Libya. Okay. That shows that what we're going to do is a lot of Type 2 errors, a lot of Type 1 errors are going to get committed in foreign policy. We're going to go out and do a lot that we shouldn't be doing. But here, at home, we're going to not do a lot that we should be doing. And it's all because of the deep structure of American politics. Now, how does this relate to our case? Tragically, the Arab-Israeli conflict gets the worst of both worlds. Because it's a foreign policy issue, there always seems to be, for these powerful, confident lawyers, an opportunity to make a name for yourself and a seeming opportunity to do what no one has ever done before, and play the role that the United States should play in the world, lead to peace in the Middle East. It's just an open door. It's hard to refuse it, and it's hard to refuse diplomatic opportunities, even if they're hopeless, for that reason. But because of the other side, the way American politics is constrained domestically, although we'll actively get involved in lots of things, we'll never be able to implement them seriously, because that will get caught up in the domestic, don't make any Type 1 errors, but we don't mind if you make Type 2 errors. That is, we don't mind if you don't do what you should do to make what you did work. So I wanted to show you how the structure of American politics plays out in this weird way in the Arab-Israeli sense. Because Israel's involved, and it's so closely tied in to the United States in so many ways, it is in one sense treated like a foreign policy problem, but in the fundamental, and that gets us into all these things that we can't really bring to conclusion. We can't do the heavy lifting, but we can do a lot of posturing. And that's what you will get. Posturing and no heavy lifting, and you'll get it again and again. I know I have very little time left. We can go into some of these things in the Q&A, but I did want to say something that wasn't totally hopeless about what I'm saying. What is the first order result of this situation? First order result is that diplomacy, under certain current circumstances, will not bring peace at all. It has no real chance of that at all. So what are the second order consequences? Well, some are good. Some are good. What's the consequence of having this hamster wheel? Some are bad. One of the bad ones is that when people think that the two-state solution could be arrived at diplomatically, they are constantly not thinking about other possibilities. So it sucks the political oxygen and the intellectual oxygen out of the atmosphere and prevents people from thinking in new ways about how the alchemy of politics could move the situation in Palestine and around Palestine beyond it. It also trains the world to believe that the United States does not mean anything it says, and that's not good. I do not believe that's a good thing. What are the good things what can we take advantage of? Number one is it ensures that every president, no matter where he starts, will eventually get disgusted with right-wing Israeli governments, because he'll get whipsawed over and over and over and humiliated. So that's a good thing. Another thing is, if from a Palestinian point of view, well, you're getting $500 million a year to help Palestinians live in the West Bank, at least. So there's a smooth aspect to this, that if you compare it to the absence of the hamster wheel, it could be much worse. There's also, you take one specific place, E1, this area between East Jerusalem and Maale Adumim, which the Israeli government is constantly wanting to settle. Repeatedly, the United States has slammed that shut. Even if it's done quietly, it's done it over and over and over again, including this administration. And that wouldn't occur without this kind of ongoing expectation of an ongoing relationship. It's also, it gives time for slow demographic changes to transform Palestine and Israel in a variety of interesting ways that we can go into later. And finally, because it provides a certain kind of time and churning, it allows for changing targets of Israeli governance. That is, I would argue that what you have is not a one-state solution, but you have a one-state outcome there. It's not a very nice state, but there is one and only one state between the river and the sea, and I don't count the PA as that state. And the question then can gradually become, and in many different domains, is this a democratic state? Is this state operating the way it should? How could it be changed? How could the values that Americans stand for be used as a metric for evaluating these policies? Now, that means that eventually, as people become more and more understanding of how meaningless the diplomatic process is, this will be an agenda that people will start to think about more seriously. Thank you.
In order to complete what you just told us, I would like to ask you a question that came to me here. How long do you think that Washington is prepared to go to support Israel? As the European states have figured out that they have started to show increased disapproval of Israel, will we reach a stage where the United States and Israel are the only two states that do not recognize Palestine?
Yes. I mean, I think it depends what you mean by recognize, but except for maybe Harper's Canada, that's basically where we are now. So the answer is yes. That's the least of our problems. I mean, the brunt of my presentation was it's not as if the United States is going to get frustrated enough to change its policies, because that implies that the policies actually have anything to do with what's going on over in the Middle East. They don't. They have to do with what goes on in the United States. So just imagine in any president's Oval Office, here comes the Middle East guy explaining what Netanyahu has been doing or what Begin's been doing or what Shamir was doing, and he's tearing his hair out, and the administration is saying, we finally have to put our foot down. This is intolerable. We're getting our, I'm not going to say anymore. But then the domestic politics guy comes in and says, Mr. President, you know, you've got a health care bill in front of Congress, or you've got an election 2 months from now. Your party's already on your back. Exactly what do you think you're going to gain by that? Do you think it's going to work, first of all? And who's going to care? And who wins that argument? The same person wins that argument all the time. Now, what is the logical implication? And you can say, when will that happen? And it was touched on in the previous panel. When the politics in this country is organized so that the voices of those who demand a different kind of policy in the Middle East are as strong or stronger than the others, then you'll see a change.
Okay. I think just a commentary also there. In the New York Times, last Friday, November 7, there was a long article by the Israel's Minister of Economy, who is the chairman of the party, the Jewish Home Party. And it's titled, For Israel, Two State is No Solution. When I read it, I remember that this is exactly what we heard from Prime Minister Shamir essentially right after the Madrid conference in the very early 90s that was convened by first President Bush and Secretary of State Jim Baker. And I think for those of you who may not have seen it, it's an excellent article that sums Israel's positions in the last 23, 24 years. And it probably will be the very basis for the Israeli, I would say that probably the paper that the Israelis would put on the table when the next stage of negotiations that you predicted will be. But the second question is for Khaled. It seems that while many people, Palestinians and non-Palestinians alike, are prepared to move on from a Washington-dominated peace process, the PLO or the PA, and they are essentially one and the same, relationship and ties to the United States prevent them from completely doing so. Do you think that paradigm will change as long as the PLO and the PA continue to rely on Washington?
Yes, please.
Well, I guess that's really the flip side of this whole situation of, on the one hand, this very dysfunctional American role in this process. A lot of it has to do with unrealistic expectations on its own part. But I think the question really touches on a very important point, and that is, really, for most of the last 40 years, the Palestinian leadership has been either seeking out the United States or heavily dependent on the United States for precisely that purpose. The purpose being there is an expectation, a belief that the United States can deliver Israel when, in fact, the United States cannot deliver Israel. And that's been shown, I think, in both word and deed. And even James Baker himself, who is one of the most popular secretaries of state as far as Palestinians are concerned, said literally, the United States is not going to deliver Israel. So there, I think there is that expectation is certainly unrealistic. I think, on the other hand, there isn't yet really an alternative to the United States. You know, it's that paradox, again, sort of cropping up in different form. I think if BDS or if the United Nations or the Arab League or you name the party or initiative, if those were viable means from the standpoint of this Palestinian leadership, they would have been pursued, I think, wholeheartedly. There would be an entire strategy. And just to modify that point a little bit more, I think it is time probably for new thinking. And that new thinking is not happening within this current Palestinian leadership, which is not surprising given the history of the Palestinian leadership and its own deficiencies, but also given the broader political failure that we're seeing across the Arab world. It's not unique to the Palestinians that they have a dysfunctional leadership that is out of touch and essentially in a state of kind of political paralysis. But I think it's symptomatic of these broader trends in the Arab world. And so that's, I guess, my way of saying it. I don't see a resolution to that anytime soon. I would expect that by the time that there is kind of a new leadership that has a new approach and a new paradigm, we're really looking at maybe even a generational shift. And in the meantime, we're going to continue to drift. People will cling to this notion of a two-state solution long after it is dead, simply for absence of alternatives.
Thank you. Is this working now?
Yeah.
Okay. I think that's an excellent answer that has long been asked, and probably if there is anything that I'm just going to go on a limb here, that I do agree with Minister Naftali, Minister Bennett, is that the two-state solution is probably dead. Now, please speak in the mic and wait for the mic. And I said that what I said because after traveling in Palestine, the West Bank, extensively over the last 3 years, there's just not enough anything to call a state in any which way or of the imagination. Bantustans is a huge over exaggeration of that. It's every two, three state reminds me of Greek kingdoms. All right, I see a lot of questions. Well, I'll start from there. Gentleman on the rear over there.
Michael Fishback, I had a question.
Yes, Dr. Fishback.
I agree with the assessment that you made, Khaled, that the Obama administration has not moved things forward at all. And yet, the Israeli press in particular constantly makes reference to this is the worst relationship since the first Bush administration. Personally, Obama and Netanyahu don't like each other. There was the whole, well, I won't say it, incident recently. How do you explain that? Is it a domestic American problem, or how is it that this administration is seen by the Netanyahu government as so hostile, and yet the rest of us, it's done precious little, seemingly, to deserve that. I have some ideas, but I'd be curious what yours are.
This one is not working, I guess. I think in a lot of ways the goalposts have shifted. The entire narrative and the space for debate has shifted. The Israeli narrative certainly has shifted to the right. The Israeli electorate has shifted to the right. Israeli politics has shifted, is shifting ever more to the right. And along with it, because of this dynamic, the relationship with the United States and particularly to American domestic politics, it's shifted the American political discourse to the right. So the expectations have moved. I think in absolute terms, Bush was much harder, George W. Bush was much harder on Ariel Sharon than Obama is on Netanyahu. And yet they had a wonderful personal relationship. They were best friends. I mean, I use that somewhat hyperbolically, but they had a very close relationship. I think a lot of it is, on the one hand, personal. You know, if they two people just don't have chemistry, they don't have chemistry. And where Obama's coming from, you know, I think, you know, you see a similar trend in domestic politics where, you know, Obama is not a socialist, but he's kind of decried as that in certain political circles in the U.S. So I think that just really has to do with the polarization, the increasing polarization of American politics, and the discourse is just getting more and more polarized and away from objectivity and reality.
Let me just say that it's very possible that with that there's an advantage of lame duck status. Remember, the first thing Obama did was actually quite aggressive, coming in and insisting on a settlement freeze and getting a kind of moratorium. People like me predicted that within 5 months this would collapse because the lobby would, after the Jewish holidays, would get mobilized, and it did. Mm-hmm. But and I think that Obama is fundamentally a pragmatist, and he just decided, nope, you know, all those people who said this was a non-winning issue are right. And basically put it on and gave it to John Kerry eventually after Hillary and the senator from Maine, Mitchell basically wasn't able to do anything. He didn't have enough presidential support. But it's possible that in the last period of time, just as he's taking an aggressive position on immigration, he might take an aggressive position, even if symbolically, to move the needle on this issue. And because that exists, and because I think we see what he actually believes in that first 8 months of his administration, you shouldn't necessarily give up trying to get him to show his true colors on this. Even though it won't mean an orchestration of an agreement, it could move the needle and change the discursive space in some very important ways.
Okay, I'm going to take three questions at a time, you know, because I see a lot of questions, and then allow the panelists to answer them. Yes.
Dr. Lustick, firstly,
yeah, three at a time.
Yeah. Okay.
Firstly, you said you would comment on the demographic situation, and I would appreciate it if you would do that. Secondly, with the election of the new Congress and the fact that the Republicans are so much more in tune with Netanyahu, might we, as was just suggested, move the needle by not vetoing a resolution in the Security Council regarding settlements? And might that be a sort of launching point for something of a new policy? And the last thing is changing the dynamic by maybe not the current PA leadership, but maybe the new generation through grassroots saying we're not interested in the two-state solution anymore. We want one man, one vote. And how might that change the dynamics of the situation?
Okay, we'll take another question in the back there before we move to the other side.
My name is Anton. So the argument was made that the failure for the U.S. diplomacy is as a result of the U.S.-Israel relations. And I would like to argue that it's not only because of that, but it's also as a result of the, or in relation to the precondition. It's a deeper reason than that. And I think it is more in the U.S. policies, which is for the president to be elected and win election, he has to show loyalty towards Israel. And so the failure to the diplomacy is not as a result to the U.S.-Israel relation, but that precondition for the for any president to start its mission and work for period.
Okay. A third one? Right there. Close to the mic, yes.
In response to one thing that Professor Lustick said on Monday evening,
what's your name, sir?
Seth Morrison. Monday evening, there's a program at GW from the SJP and the Arab Students Association on how the Palestinian community can learn from the Jewish community in terms of political organizing. So if anybody'd like to come to that, it's 6 p.m. And then in terms of a question, I'm curious about the Palestinian Authority's UN strategy and whether they will get enough votes in the Security Council to bring a vote to the General Assembly that could move statehood forward. Thank you.
Okay. These are the three questions. We'll allow the panelists to answer them before we take another set of three.
Well, I'll just respond to your question, your three questions. On the demographics, just a few things. I'm sorry. On the demographics, 3 points. First of all, from the river to the sea, it's about 50-50. In terms of, and I actually think that there are more Arabs than Jews, because you get, it has to do with how many of the non-Arabs you count as Jews. There's a lot, maybe 350,000 to 400,000 immigrants from the former Soviet Union who are not Jewish. That is, they don't claim to be Jewish, and they're not claimed to be Jewish, but they're added to the statistics for political reasons. And then, of course, if you count the guest workers and others, or they're legally or illegally, the question is, well, who are you counting that's in the country? That's another population that's not Arab or not Jewish. But then if you just look at the children in the schools from the river to the sea, it's very, there's a majority of Arabs. So that's one thing to keep in mind. And those trends are continuing. Now, it is true that there's somewhat of a small increase in the Jewish birth rate, mainly due to the ultra-Orthodox. And that's kind of stabilized, but it's still within not extraordinarily high. But there has been a significant drop in the Arab birth rate. But the Arab rate of natural increase is still very much higher than the Jewish rate because of demographic momentum. That is, all the youth bulges from the past, and because their birth rates are still high and their death rates fell. All of that stuff is, unfortunately, the meat and potatoes of a lot of Israeli discourse, where it handles people as political pawns. And part of that discourse that I became involved in was a project by the settlers, somebody named Yoram Ettinger, who used to be a diplomat in the United States, and he organized this project to convince Israelis that the whole idea of the demographic challenge was phony, meant to get Israel out of the lands it really should be ruling. The truth was that both the Central Bureau of Statistics in Israel and the Palestinian Central Bureau of Statistics were conspiring to lie about the number of Palestinians in the West Bank, and that they had reduced the number, that actually the number was at 1 million to 1.5 million fewer. And they wrote a 140-page book, about a 100-page book with 145 footnotes saying why this was true. And I, for my previous life sins, decided to analyze every footnote in this book, and I published an article about it in the Middle East Journal last summer saying that it was a fraud. And I actually debated Ettinger in Jerusalem to this effect, and I can tell you about why that happened. But my point is that most settlers, almost all settlers, and most of the right believes this. And if you go out on their webs, you'll see that Ettinger and his phony demographers are recruited as expert witnesses. When you talk about immigration over the long run, look at the changing estimates of immigration and emigration from the country. There's a lot of talk among Israelis and the right about how, well, you know, the Arabs are leaving, the Palestinians are leaving. We even heard it today. The situation is so desperate that people are taking their lives into their own hands and getting out of there, no matter how difficult it is to get out. And that's understandable. But what Israelis don't like to talk about is the number of Israelis, Jews, leaving the country. And it's not those numbers are high enough that they kind of cancel out the relatively small number of immigrants who are coming. So Zionism as an immigrant-absorbing state has kind of failed over, in that by that measurement over the last decade and a half. Once the former Soviet Union immigrants and the Ethiopian immigrants stopped coming, well, it's basically a wash between emigration and immigration. But more importantly, even than that, is who's emigrating. And what's amazing is the extent to which secular, liberal, well-educated Israelis are leaving because, first of all, they have more opportunity, but they can also get passports as Europeans to EU countries. And I think now, as you may know, that one of the top stories in Israeli press this summer was Berlin. Was right. The fact that Berlin is the fastest growing Israeli city in the world, and this is not just economic; it's also psychological and political. But whether the extent to which it is a big debate inside of Israel. That's what I had to say.
On the Security Council question, I mean, look, I don't have any inside information as to, you know, how many votes have been lined up, who's lobbying what and where, and which countries are likely to vote yes or no, or even if it's going to come to a vote. But I think it's fairly clear that the United States, you know, whether an initiative like that passes or fails, I think will have a lot to do with the role the U.S. plays. If the U.S. vetoes or if they abstain, obviously very significant. And to what extent, even if they might even be able to prevent a vote from coming to the Security Council the way they did on the statehood bid, tied up in procedural matters or whatever. So I mean, again, I don't have any inside information as to how the vote would come, but it's pretty clear that the U.S. would play a role. I would think that as a lame duck administration in the second half of its second administration, that they would have more room to maneuver. And frankly, if you're going to be accused of throwing Israel under the bus, then you might as well earn it on some level. Do something that, you know, and I don't consider a UN Security Council veto to be actually throwing Israel under the bus. I think it helps to level the playing field and certainly doesn't qualify under that characterization. But if you're going to get blamed for that hyperbolically, then you might as well at least do something in that direction. I think it's very difficult. I mean, I think we all understand that there are these domestic political constraints, but it's hard to justify them when you are a second-term lame duck in your second half of your second administration. And you already lost the midterm election. So the political costs have been paid. So you might as well get something in return.
First of all, I want to say that, yes, I think the UN Security Council resolution opportunity is a place where the needle can be moved a little bit. I definitely agree with that. But I wanted to pick up on your one man, one vote comment. We said maybe I have been advocating and will be writing about the possibility of changing the way people like us have looked at East Jerusalem and look at the possibility of Arabs there voting. In East Jerusalem, in Jerusalem elections, you know, it takes 120,000 votes in Jerusalem to elect a mayor. The Arabs, if they voted, even in relatively small numbers, would have at least 50,000 votes. Imagine that Arabs and seculars, or Arabs and even ultra-Orthodox, would be able to run that city, making life for Palestinians much better, and having a kind of working model of democracy between Jews and Arabs, in which democracy has a funny effect. It makes strange bedfellows. It can be creative. Now, there's not going to be another Jerusalem municipality election for another few years, but start talking about that is itself useful. Of course, who's going to be the main voice against it? Palestinian Authority. Okay, so these are issues for us to think about and work on when we look ahead to that new generation's demands.
Okay,
I'm going to take two questions from here, then one from here. The gentleman here in the green shirt.
Thank you. My name's Lee Diamond. I have to say I feel a bit like Obama's being blamed for being president, and I think Dr. Lustick may have alluded to that a bit with his efforts. You know, I wonder, I've been thinking about some of the points you raised actually the last several weeks, Dr. Lustick, and wondering whether we couldn't, you know, because there is an urgent need for new thinking in terms of all the points you raised, have a tripartite bottom-up movement of Israelis, Palestinians, and Americans, and there's a lot of assets out there. There's a lot of NGOs, both joint NGOs and independent NGOs from Palestinian and Israeli society, and then other NGOs from around the world, and foundation money going in, and so on and so forth. And if we had the capacity to do things like create model parliaments, or, you know, because I mean, I know people from, you know, who are having discussion groups around bereaved families, and they go around the country, or they have local groups. So if there was some way to network, and some of these networking things are happening already, to, you know, pull that together, we couldn't create alternative models, because I've lost faith in it too, because of the stasis that you've discussed with regard to Israel. Israel has its own stasis. It's fracturing. The proportional representation system already fails much of the Israeli polity, and our own country is infamous for that now as well. So,
okay.
Hi, Paul Verdine. I have a question that's similar to the last gentleman's, but I can speak it in a lot less time. I feel like looking for new solutions. I want to put something on the table that's way out of the box. And one of the panelists raised the question as to whether the U.S. needed to be involved as a broker in negotiations between Israel and Palestine. But I would like to suggest, why does any one country, have to be involved when the United States has failed so miserably and Britain before them? The international BDS movement is gaining momentum by the day, particularly in Europe. 40% of Israel's trade is with Europe, as I understand it. Could not the constraints of the BDS movement, the effect on Israel, bring Israel to the point where they have to recognize that their policies toward the Palestinians are untenable? And then, because nobody wants to trade with them anymore, and as the third world continues to develop and can provide the same products that Israel is producing, we get to the point where Israel begs the U.S. or some other major world power to please help us, you know, negotiate.
And what is your question, sir?
Well, do you think that that possibility that option might bear fruit in time without any one government being involved?
Okay. The third question is going to go to the journalist standing to Mr. Arakan.
Thank you, Dr. Ali. Thank you, Dr. Lustick. I have a very quick question on the issue of demography.
Can you hear me?
No. Okay. Okay, about now. All right. Okay, on the issue of demography. Demography is often cited to underscore that the occupation is not sustainable. But has it, in fact, been sustainable and thriving and so on, and could conceivably go for a long time despite the demographic explosion? Thank you.
Okay, that's the three questions
to Dr. Lustick.
Yes, the occupation of, if you mean Israeli rule of the West Bank. Oh, sorry. If by occupation you mean the Israeli rule of the West Bank, East Jerusalem, and basically domination of Gaza without any political rights to the people who live there, even if those populations, especially in the West Bank, become much bigger, yes. South Africa was able to sustain an oppressive regime over decades and generations with many fewer whites versus non-whites. So the answer is yes. Demography itself will not do it. But what is going to be more decisive is political trends inside of Israel. And demography is a bogey inside of Israel. People are very concerned about that. And they're concerned about it because they really are terrified of Arabs. Most Israelis are simply terrified. Before the abduction of the teenagers in the West Bank, before all that, I was at the King David Hotel trying to get a taxi to my hotel in East Jerusalem near Salah Adin Street, right in the middle of the commercial district. Two Israeli Jewish taxi drivers refused to drive me to the commercial district. I said, what are you talking about? I said, this is Israel's United Capital. We're not taking you there. So the third one agreed. He said, oh, of course I'll take you. So I said, well, that's fine. I got in the car with my suitcase and my backpack and my computer, and he took me to the huge police station there, and he would not go any further. He said, I'm not going in there. I said, it's just a couple of... No. So he kicked me out of the taxi, and I had to walk with my luggage. So that's how United Jerusalem, but that's how afraid. He says, look, you don't know. You probably don't know these people, but they'll kill you. Just turn your back. You get a knife. So I'll take you back to the King David. You know, this is the kind of culture. They're afraid. Don't think that they are super confident. So demography matters.
Just real quick, before you tackle the other issues, on the demographics, I'm fascinated, actually, by the story you alluded to, your debate with Edinger. I'd love to hear more about that offline. But on this issue, I think we're also seeing, in addition to the denial and the conspiracy theories, we're also seeing a trend in the Israeli right wing where they're saying Israel can absorb at least the West Bank Palestinians, whatever their numbers are. They're clearly not negligible. You know, it would be easy, I think, to absorb 300,000 Palestinians in Jerusalem without tipping the demographic balance at all. But here you're talking about 3 million Palestinians, or at least, right, 3 or 4 million? 3 million, 2.5 million. In the West Bank, that would very much tip Israel's demographic balance, and yet we're seeing some on the Israeli right saying, even then we can still absorb them as citizens without affecting at least the Jewish character of the state. Mm-hmm. And it may be because they're willing to sacrifice the democratic versus the Jewish.
Right. That's exactly why. They imagine that they'll be able to pretend to give political rights to the Arabs. Yes, we will give opportunities. They can apply for citizenship. First, they have to learn Hebrew. And then they have to go in the army, and et cetera, et cetera. There's all kinds of tricks. There are some Israeli politicians, even extreme right-wingers like F.E.A. Tom, who have said, no, I don't know tricks. I really am ready to do this. And I respect that. Yes, Rivlin is talking this way, too, the president. When I asked Edinger at the debate, I'll tell you one thing that happened is I repeatedly said to him and to the group, this was at a right-wing forum, I said, I can prove first of all, not only that what he's saying is absolutely false and fraudulent, but that he himself does not believe it. I can prove it. And so I said, how can I prove it? And he's sitting right there. I said, because if he believed it, he would call for giving equal voting rights to all the Arabs there and annexing it. Annexing it as a full part of Israel, which means you impose citizenship on the Arabs. But he knows that his argument is not true, and so he will not do that, and instead talk about keeping the areas but not the population. Now, what I want to say is if I've done work on Ireland and Britain and France and Algeria. One of the interesting things about Ireland is that it was settled by the British for centuries, and in 1800 it was annexed. They had about 20% Protestant settlers and the rest Catholics with no rights. The Catholics weren't allowed to vote. Not until the mid-19th century, 1829, the vote. By the 1870s, all Catholic men could vote, and they became, in the Parnell Party, the crucial political weight in the parliament that decided whether the liberals or the conservatives were on the country. The ultimate result was an alone plan and partition. So you get a separate Irish state that seceded from the United Kingdom after a binational state had been created. So politics is a very has its own logics, and you can't, and most of the time when problems like this get solved, they don't get solved because somebody's architected solution that they planned for gets imposed, but logics and unintended consequences of plans take over. and the unintended consequences of the kinds of things the right is doing, including Naftali Bennett, to absorb all these people, they're going to create opportunities for worldwide struggles against oppression of people who have or are not enjoying equal rights in the state.
Three more questions. Over here, the first one.
Can you see this mediation?
Yes, we'll let her go next. I've already called on somebody here, and you're next.
Okay.
Yes.
My name is Michelle Steinberg. I write for EIR News. I have a question about Jewish extremism. And it was mentioned about the kidnapping of the Jewish yeshiva students. And then right after that, almost very shortly before the latest invasion war on Gaza, there was the horrible killing, torture of Abu Qadir. I'd like to everyone remember that and pay homage to that. There's been very little news about who did that. There's four people on trial. Professor Lustick, you've written about these guys over the years. I've written about it. And I think there's a horrible radicalization of the right, which goes beyond when they were a fringe. We just celebrated or remembered the 19th anniversary of Yigal Amir, a settler, crazy person's killing of Yitzhak Rabin. Right after the Knesset voted land for peace. So we're looking at, I think, a phenomenon. I'd like to hear from both speakers on how to get more attention to this Jewish extremism, because I think it's at the heart of probably what we're going to hear about in the next panel, the assaults and the threatening remarks about the Al-Aqsa Mosque, et cetera. So please, thank you.
Okay, over here, as we promised. Could you wait for the microphone, please, because we have the live audience and...
Hello, I'm Rosemary. Can you hear me now?
Now we can.
Okay. Dr. Lustick, I want to make a comment to you, or Professor Lustick. I'd like to make a comment to you, so you might consider it in your future writings, how Israel can go from a theocracy to a democracy by creating a one-state condominium slash solution with Jerusalem as a united capital for all citizens. Each equal voting rights, one economy, one currency, religious freedom, and that's my comment. And I think that's a good proposal to start with. What do you think about that?
All right, we'll take one more question before Professor Lustick answers, and that probably will be our last, simply because we have a 15 minutes break after that, and then we will go the last one on Jerusalem. And some of your questions may be asked during that. All right, here's the gentleman in the back right there, been trying for a long time to. Yes.
Hello, Edward Goldstein. Is this working?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
For Mr. Elgindy, I hope I pronounced that right. I noticed as a possible successor to the United States as mediator, you did not mention the EU, and the EU seems to have be crystallizing some very definite ideas about what Israel should and should not be doing, and they have been willing to move towards sanctions. Unfortunately, maybe their credibility is compromised by some eruptions of violent anti-Semitism, but that's not the EU per se. My question to you is, do you see any possibility that the EU will liberate itself from American pressure and become a more assertive mediator, perhaps, in place of the United States? And then to Dr. Lustick, what do you think of the notion not only of Palestinian nationalism in East Jerusalem transforming into a civil rights movement, one person, one vote, but what about all over the West Bank? I know some Palestinians are discussing this seriously. There have been freedom rides, as it were, the possibility of a Palestinian civil rights movement. What do you think of that possibility? Thank you.
Thank you. We will answer the questions, then we will go for a 15-minute break.
On the EU, I think you're right. Europe has shown its willingness to kind of break from at least American policy or American approach to this, and is willing to do things like we saw the House of Commons vote. There are votes upcoming also in Spain, the Spanish Parliament and French parliaments. But at the same time, I think those are precisely the reasons why Europe can't serve as a mediator. It's not only because of this these incidences of anti-Semitism. The standard is hardly that objective or constructive. It's simply Europe is dismissed, I think, by the Israelis as being biased toward the Palestinians wholesale. I mean, there is a wholesale dismissal of Europe as such. There are obviously there is a range. Germany is different than Italy or Spain or France in very important ways. There is a spectrum, but Europe as Europe, you know, Europe has always been way ahead, light years ahead of the United States. But when push comes to shove, and this is one of the reasons that makes this whole notion of the quartet, I think, such a total fiction and completely vacuous, is Europeans complain on the one hand that the Americans dominate and monopolize the process, but as soon as a crisis happens, the Europeans are saying, hurry up, United States, you need to act now. Only the United States can do this, and they readily and happily cede the ground to the United States. So again, I think a lot of this it may even be tactical. It has to do with their own domestic politics, these initiatives, but it's also, I think, a way for them to put pressure on the United States to get its act together and do what it needs to do. So, no, I don't see any real chance that Europe will play that role.
Okay, really quickly, Michelle, you know, one of the advantages of these fanatics on the Jewish side, like the Temple Mount faithful, they want to rebuild the temple, is they actually, from the point of view of Netanyahu himself and most Israeli ultra-nationalists, they're going too far. They're really too extreme and they're dangerous. But they cannot denounce them in principle. And since they can't denounce them in principle, it offers opportunities to exploit that fact by those who want to say, look, there's a danger to the Middle East, and it's this kind of ultra-nationalist Jewish fanaticism. There are other dangers because there are other ultra-nationalist fanatics in the Middle East, including in Iran. What's going to come up soon is, an American brokered deal on Iran. It's going to infuriate the Israel lobby, infuriate Israel. That's something we haven't been talking about. But one of the things Obama's involved in is that, and that's going to generate a reaction. And in that context, there will be room for arguments about, wait a minute, Iran is not the only place where there are wacko extremists. You've also got them in Israel. So let's see what the real problem is. So that's on that point, and I won't go in any more detail about that. You paint what I call a very pretty picture of a future that I would love to live in. And I can paint that picture myself. I can't paint it. I can see it. I can also see a picture of two states, each different. I can see a picture of 10 cantons, where there's a canton in the Galilee that's Arab, and Arabs can immigrate into that, and there's a canton in Tel Aviv that's is Jewish, and the Jews can immigrate in it. And the question is not, can we produce these pictures, but how do we get there? How do we get to anyone? The reason I mentioned East Jerusalem is because there's a little place where you can start to experiment with a process that might unintendedly lead in that direction, or at least show that it's possible. I don't have a path to any of those pictures. That's why I don't claim to have a solution. I only am claiming to be ready to do the thinking that hasn't been done yet to know how to move to one of those pictures. And I think that basically answers Ed's question too, I think, about Palestinian nationalism in the West Bank. Yes, it's there, but East Jerusalem is the place where it'll, if it's real, will first materialize.
Okay, this has been a fantastic hour and a half. I think that you have heard the word Jerusalem quite a few times in the last hour and a half. Our last panel will be on Jerusalem, a core issue. So please stay and participate in the next. We will take a 15-minute break. Thank you.